husband passed away, Ms. Ridener, so we need to remember her in our prayers, and any one of the staff members that wants to give money to the flower fund, Ms. Gail's got the envelope up here, and we want to remember her and her family. Mike passed away last night, so Gail will inform all the board members as to when the arrangements will be made. Steve? Ms. Faye?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Everybody please sign in.
Locked.
It's locked.
Before they're unlocking this thing, Dale, I want you to take a moment. We've lost one of our board members. We won't have a seated member from the 5th District until sometime in November, I would assume, would be the December meeting.
Correct.
And go through our process.
I was in contact with Mr. City that won the election for one of the delegate seats, and he chose to not accept his election. Very nice man, I want to say, the feelings that I had with him on the telephone. The Campbell County Commission, in theory, has the ability, if they want to fill the seat, but my belief is that since it's so close to your next election, which would be the November 8th presidential election, that they're going to leave the seat unfilled, which is their right, and then when the November election occurs, that board member would be seated on December the 1st. So right now, you have a 9-member board, so it will only take 5 votes to enact any sort of, to enforce any sort of action you take, as opposed to the normal 6.
Okay. Yeah, and I think they're taking applications now for candidates, petitions they're filing now with election commission. Is that right, Crystal?
Mm-hmm. Actually, tomorrow is the deadline.
Tomorrow's the deadline. So any people back here in the 5th District wants to run, you got until tomorrow to pick up and run. Does anybody have any questions for Mr. Cantrell about this, about the vote count? If you would, everybody sign in that you're present. Hit press yes and confirm, please. Show us roll. Every September, the board, by state law, has to elect a chair and a vice chair. So we'll turn the meeting over to Mr. Nyfer and we'll take nominations.
At this time, do I have any nominations for the chairman of the board?
I guess that's what I'm
saying. I'll make a motion to nominate Matthew.
We have a second.
You don't have to have a second.
No second on nomination.
Second on nomination.
You have to vote here.
I move nomination cease.
And I second that motion.
Yes.
Cast your vote. Anyone wish to change your vote?
Wait, press green.
Confirm anybody wants to change your vote. How long?
Corey, yes. Bain, yes. Merge.
I thank you all. We've worked together another year, and I look forward to working with Ms. Fields and Mr. Lester, too. Now we're going to open the floor up for nominations for a vice chair. Do I have any nominations?
I nominate Clint Bain.
Do I have any other nominations?
I make a motion the nomination cease.
If you would, cast your vote.
And you do need a second.
A second for nominations to cease.
Second.
Thank you. Cast your vote, please. Hit yes and press confirm. Anyone wish to change their vote? Show us the vote.
Corey, yes. Bane, yes. Burge, yes. Strickland, abstain. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, concerning the chair and the co-chair, they have an orientation in Nashville, and I have the dates here, and I'll give that information to you.
Okay, thank you.
It's for the chair and the co-chair.
Thank you. First item is to recognize guests. I think we have two here tonight. First guest, I would like for Steve, you're back there. You get closer up here. We got a few questions we need to ask you about this nursing program. Maybe Johnny, you may want to join him since you did that last year. First person on the agenda is Ms. Millsap. You'll come up to the, there's not even a, I have a microphone. Well, they just had cord. I guess they didn't have a microphone. If you just maybe come up behind Dale there, that's fine. We can hear you. And okay. Ms. Millsap has been, I think she's discussed this with several board members. We've talked several times last year and this year, and I'm going to turn it over to her.
Thank you all for having me. What I'm wanting to bring up is for you all to find funding to get an additional nurse or more if possible. My son's a type 1 diabetic at Garrable. I think some of you guys know him. His name's Rick Tech. Right now, the nurse situation at the school that he goes to is at part-time, and I believe it's part-time at all the schools. His nurse is Sarah Massendale. She does an awesome job with him, but she's not there all day. So we need more money.
And just a little history, Ms. Millsap, she contacted some of us members that's been on here last year. Last fall, after school got started, and we worked with Mr. Nidifer and Jeff and Richard, and they identified some monies that we had, and we hired a part-time nurse to fill some delay there. That lady this year took another position, and it wasn't in our budget this year. And the only thing I don't understand is we've had individuals that's willing to work that at part-time, like Ms. Longmire. Why can we not hire a person with a RN degree to be a part-time nurse? Yes.
I think that what the answer to that is because of the amount of money that we have allotted there, the 23 or whatever, it would not fit in with the RN pay scale.
So we do have an RN pay scale in our system?
RN and FPN both have pay scales.
Okay.
Question for Mr. Rutherford. Could we find monies for an LPN rather than a RN?
That's totally up to you guys. We could definitely put a nurse full-time at Carroll with an additional nurse.
I talked to, I think it was Johnny, one of them today. Do you have a plan on filling that position at Carroll to try to make up that difference, that delay?
You're talking about
yes.
Somebody in mind for that
mm-hmm.
position?
Or a plan that maybe use
application for that job. We do have a plan maybe to cover until we can get somebody, if we get the money to get somebody. And what that would be for some of the medications and stuff to be given at some of the schools by secretaries or whatever, which is allowable, and they are trained to do that, which would allow Sarah probably to go back to Carol. She was feeling like from 8 to 11:15 on Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Carol. And then she would go to Jacksonville Middle School from 11:45 to 12:30. And then from 12:30 to 1 half lunch, and then back to Carol from 1 to 3:30. So what that's doing is Ms. Millsap is kind of concerned about, number one, being there for checking before lunch, after lunch, and then he's going to be attending an after school program, my understanding. Is that we would have somebody there for that also. That's going to give her like maybe on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays, 5 hours to 45 minutes of Carroll. And then on Mondays and Wednesdays, I'd have to send her to Elk Valley maybe an hour on Monday, an hour on Wednesday, just to give them some coverage. And that would give her about 4 hours and 15 minutes on those days. Now, we do have another situation. We have a lady at Jacksboro Elementary who also issues math at 2 o'clock also. So she could let the secretaries do that, and then she could cover some of it too if she needed.
What about, have you give thought to what's going to happen with that position when Sarah goes on her maternity leave?
We have some already in place. And so we have really, you know, we were just coming to the board now, and we were, in other words, she already had a schedule, and it wasn't been, it's been going to Caribou, to Jacksboro, and staying at Jacksboro till the end of the day.
Well, the problem that we have is we earn 1.8 nurses. Is that right, Jeff?
That's correct.
And we are spending about a little less than $500,000 towards, I think it's $430,000 or $450,000. So it's not in our budget, so we would have to identify money or ask the finance department to identify money, and then Steve would have to ask for applications and go through the process. So now I'm going to open it up for a board member.
I would like this to be a permanent fixture in your budget, not a temporary, because my son is in third grade, and, you know, as I explained to you and Steve, he got this when he was in fifth grade, I mean, excuse me, kindergarten. So it wasn't something that we planned on when we moved to Campbell County. And other counties, I think, seem to attest to this, have full-time nurses that are close by that we can switch our children to.
I think you told me they were within a mile of one another,
yes, I mean,
which is similar to what Caribou
yes,
is.
Yes, but they're a lot closer. They don't have to get on a main road or anything like that. I mean, I would feel more comfortable in a situation where my child had a nurse there. It's not the teacher's responsibility, in my opinion, to monitor my child's blood sugar, because they're not educated in the medical field to know what to do when he's low or high. I mean, for instance, yesterday he was 344, and then before he left, he was at 40. I mean, if he passes out or something, I mean, that's a liability and it's a safety concern. And this doesn't need to be, like I said, a temporary fix just to make me happy, because I mean, there's other kids involved, not just my child.
Board members, any questions? Ms. Millsap or Steve? It's a funding issue, so of course it's, she's here to discuss this tonight, and it's left up to us to direct Mr. Nidefer on the funding issue. What are you going to do if you hire someone? You're going to hire, oh, you've got a part-time nurse now, right, that's going to fill in?
She's sucked.
Okay.
If we hire her plan would be that we got an additional part-time nurse, is that we would be a person, Sarah, at Caribou all day, and that person would then become responsible for whoever we hire, Elk Valley, Jacksboro, Middle.
And then you'd use the part-time nurse more, is what you're saying?
If we were
the sub-nurse, the fill-in nurse.
Oh, you're talking about right now?
Yes.
If we were able to hire somebody in that position, we would be able to do that.
Yeah, because once Sarah goes on maternity leave, you're going to have to hire some people
right
part time.
Well, if Sarah goes on maternity leave right now, Elk Valley will not have that. They haven't had coverage this year. They did last year. They will not have coverage.
Yes, Ms.
I also think the school board and Mr. Nidefer need to look at how they have the nurses that they have placed, because at La Follette, it's my understanding there's no diabetics. And not that other children's health concerns overtake a diabetic, but I mean, in some situations they would, depending on the medical need of the child. They just need to be administered medication that a you know, a teacher or a principal or a secretary could dispense. Then why aren't those people being used and sent to like the alternative school or these other schools? I don't think that that's something that's been looked at, is how you are using what you already have as a whole. I mean, it's my understanding from speaking with Mr. Rutherford, there's not, you know, that's not something that's been mapped out, that's been looked at, as to how you all use what you already have also.
Like I've told you several times, it's a funding issue, and the board's got to find the money. We got an item on the agenda tonight to help fund half of an SRO that we've been trying for years to put SROs in all of our schools because of we're testament to what can happen in a school when our shooting happened. All right, Ms. Fay?
I have a question for Steve. Well, first of all, I would be in favor of trying to find the money to fund that full-time nurse because of the health issues. But the other question is, if we do hire a part-time person, would that help alleviate teachers and secretaries having to dispense medicine to children? That concerns me a little.
Have that come up some places sometimes, just because of traveling in between schools. But now those secretaries are trained, and it's this medication. It's not really diabetes. It's
okay.
Okay. Medicines or things like that.
Okay.
And usually, if it's that serious of a drug, they recommend they take them in the house.
Okay.
Mike, now you want to say something in regard to what Ms. Millsap is talking about. I studied at another school. When I left that school that day, there was a diabetic there who's in first grade. I was not comfortable actually leaving and going to another school. That is how high that was, what you know what.
Yeah, I've heard the horror stories about Connor.
I mean, the teacher, she and I kept texting and she kept calling me, and I kept thinking to myself, what is going to happen with this little boy? You know, have a seizure, or his blood sugar drops so low he can't be read, and he goes unconscious. To me, I'm like her. That's leaving not just me, but my license, but the school board and the county open.
The only thing that concerns me is we're sitting here and we don't have a nurse in every school. We know that. We can't afford to put a nurse in every school because it costs us $1 million, I guess.
But is that not better than having some of these kids missing because they're
But what's going to happen, the board's going to have to address, if we're going to address nurses, we're going to have to address nurses. And I think Johnny tried to do this back a year or so ago when he was handling the job. It's because what would happen if there's another Miss Millsap goes into another school as part-time? I mean, we're going to set a precedent. Are we going to put a nurse in every school? I mean, you know.
In some cases it calls for.
Something else that I know some of the other school systems do is they have designated schools where they do have a full-time nurse. And
like at an elementary school?
School,
well, that makes sense.
The county to provide transportation for the kids that don't live there or don't have access for those particular schools.
Where you say that this elementary school is designated as a full-time nurse.
And if you want your child to have that care, then you have the option at the school board or the school expense to transport them to.
Well, what do you all do in Anderson County?
You've got two laws you have to be aware of. One's a state, one's a federal law. If a child is under a 504 plan, that designates that they have nursing care. There's a federal component that funds that part of the plan, and that child has to have the nurse that follows them. So you can't necessarily shift that child to another school unless the parents agree. And then you have the IEP under the federal law that there could be a designated nurse. So what the state now wants you to do is you have to have one funded RN, okay, under your VP formula, which draws 1.8. So that funds you one RN, and then we went to all LPNs, and we figured how many we could fund through 504 or through federal money, and we tried to disperse them there. We're a little different than you guys because the proximity of our schools allow for one nurse to cover multiple schools, because like North Northwest Elementary with a walking distance from each other. So when we came up with our plan, we filled 504 funds and then IEP second, because that was a federal component, so it didn't cost us any money. Then we saw how many LPNs you could use, which have to keep one RN. The idea of going to all the kids to one school can be a little problematic, just because a parent has the ability, if they're under an IEP, to say, I don't want to leave my home school, and you can't force transfer that school.
Steve, how many RNs do we have?
We were just talking, we've had three out of six.
Yeah. And we use two in Anderson County, one on each end of the county, and the rest of the county.
But you don't have one in every school?
No.
Question? Ms. Fay has requested that Mr. Neidifer and Steve look into trying to come up with a funding solution.
Just to check into it and see what can be done.
Okay. It's obvious that we can't do anything tonight. Can you all do that?
Yes, sir.
Steve? Ms. Millsap, we appreciate you coming, we really do.
I appreciate you coming.
And we wish your son the best of luck. He plays football, I know, I've seen some pictures of him. Thank you. We have one more person here. Brian Horton was supposed to be here. Come on. Yeah, Steve's here, come on up here. Steve, their group.
I'm working on the next best thing.
Better looking anyway, right? He's here, as y'all know, they presented some stuff to us last year, and they're doing a great job up at the high school with the soccer field. I drove by there Saturday, and I don't know how many people just had out there working.
We had about 30 or 35, I guess, out there working Saturday.
And there's building all kinds of stuff. And he's going to tell us where they are in their construction phase, because I know some of you have been getting a lot of calls about, you know, what's going on with the dirt. And I think Johnny mentioned at the meeting the other night, some of the officials asked you what was going on up there with all that pretty grass that got removed. But tell us where you are.
Okay, well, we started, it's about a year ago is when I came to you the first time, and I presented you a budget, and I've left a packet for everybody. That's that first page. That was the original budget that we gave you guys. Where we are today, the field is just about ready to play. In fact, our goal is to play the last two games of the girls' season, which is going on right now. That will be September the 30th and October the 3rd. Our goal is to play those two games on that field. October the 3rd will be senior night. So we've really been pushing to get our seniors a chance to play on the field, because they've got a lot of time invested in the field, too, whether it's picking up rocks or putting up fences or whatever. But as you can see when you drive by, the field's just about ready for play. Irrigation system is in place and it's functional. Obviously, we're looking at the grass. We've got a gravel parking area up there in place, new fencing surrounding the field and the parking lot. We've got our storage building there and in place and painted. That's the blue building you see out front. Mm-hmm. There'll be a press box on top of that. We already have the materials on site to build that. It's just a matter of getting, you know, constructed. We've started construction on our covered benches. We'll have a covered bench for both the visitor and the home team, and those materials are all on site. We have a scoreboard that's currently taking up basically the conference room, the Bryant Bank, that we're in the process of refurbishing. And we're in the middle of putting a drainage system in. You see a W Coleman, a ditch last night, and it'll be filled with rock and have a drainage system so the field will drain properly. And we've got bleachers on site. That was an unexpected find we got on at an auction website, and needs a little refurbishing, but there is a bargain. So we're in pretty good shape there. If you look at that second page, that is basically everything we've done to date and an estimated cost to go with it. And you can see at the bottom, that $147,748, that's quite a bit more than that original budget that we proposed back in October of last year. Of that $147,748, there are no bills hanging out there. That's all paid and in place or in process. And the county's got $21,500 invested.
That includes this board and the county commission, right?
Correct.
Okay.
That's Kimball County as a whole, though, has $21,500 invested in that. The rest has been through donations, labor, you name it. But a lot of good folks have really stepped up to the plate and helped us out here to get that done. If you turn to the third page, these are the remaining items that we need to finish that project, basically. You can see the money there. $23,500 is the estimated cost for that. What we are asking for or proposing is an additional $15,000 to help us wrap this up. We think we can get it done for $15,000. It'll take a few more phone calls and a little more beg, borrow, and stealing, but we think for $15,000 we can finish that up, and that will have that project completed.
Yeah, and like Steve said, you know, we've got we gave $15,000 or $18,000. What was it, Jeff? The county gave $35,000.
Well, you split it. The original was $17,600, and we split that.
And then we came back and paid for some water.
$500 for the water tap.
For the water tap, that's right. And I think last year in our budget, we took it out of capital outlay because it wasn't a reoccurring item, unlike salaries and stuff like that. So where are we on our capital outlay money?
We're good.
Okay. Any questions for Steve?
I think it's a great job. I've been by there several times. It's amazing.
We, last night, we took the roller and basically smoothed the ridges out of the field. It's really playable right now. We've got a few little things to do, but that's why we think we can get the girls on there this season to let them play at their school. You know, they're really excited about that. We're pretty confident.
Okay. Any questions for Steve?
No questions, just thank you for the job you've done thus far.
Good job. Of course, it's not on our agenda tonight. We can't take it up. Yeah. We'll put it on there for next month and see what we can do.
Right.
Tell Steve, tell Brian and all of them, we really appreciate it.
Chairman, you don't have to have a vote at the school board.
I'm sorry?
You don't have to have a vote at the school board.
To do what?
If you want to raise a...
Because it's less than $25,000 or $20,000?
Yeah, it's coming out, Capitol Outlay.
And you want to make a contribution, right?
Well, I haven't had a motion to that effect yet. What is the pleasure? We'll stick it on there next month and vote on it next month. Is that okay?
Okay. That'll work.
Tell Brian we appreciate it.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Can I get a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Mr. Chair, I make a motion we approve the consent agenda.
I have a motion. Can I have a second?
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Any discussion? Cast your vote. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us a vote.
11 yes, 3 yes, Bird yes, Creekmore yes, Fields yes, Goins abstained.
Heatherly,
yes.
Lester,
yes. Motion passed.
Thank you. On the regular agenda, we've got an addenda item that is going to be D4. Ms. Gale passed that out to y'all. And Clint mentioned something to me before the meeting got started. They'll touch the architect's cost over at the Wynn School.
Yeah, can I speak on that?
Yeah.
I guess I talked to Dale earlier because I talked to Jeff and Larry. I interpret the Tennessee TCA code that it does not require an architect to replace a gym floor. But I would like to ask Mr. Cantrell to speak and see if I'm correct in that or not.
I checked on that with what we do with Michael Brady Architecture Firm, because we keep them on a pay for every job that we do. My understanding is that the footprint of the building itself is not changed, meaning that we don't change any of the walls, any of the existing footprint, or if you don't alter an interior structure, like putting a closet or something in, or you don't remove a fixture, like in a gymnasium, the only fixtures I can think of would be like a bleachers that are hard fixed into the floor, but you don't have to have an architect's approval to put down a new floor. You can put it in the carpet or hardwood as long as you're not altering the footprint of the building.
Okay.
Okay, with that said, can we move? I'd like to move that over. I guess,
yep.
Where did you want to move
we're
it?
We're going to move, for the agenda, we're going to move item 9A over to items of discussion for I. If we could do that, please. And while we're on item I, we're going to remove item 8D, consider approving all classified employees holiday sick and vacation days. Ms. Rodner is not, she chairs that policy committee. She wasn't here tonight. And there's been some discussion over the last 2 days about concerns with that policy. So we're going to take it up in a workshop before the end of the month. We'll get that scheduled once Sharon gets through her.
So are we saying to delete D?
Deleting D.
No, 8D.
You may want to move these over, Matt.
8D and whatever.
We're going to have 8I. We're going to move Wynn over for items of for action. 9.
There's already an 8I.
Okay, it's 8I. It's 8.
J.
It's J. I'm sorry. J. So we're moving Wynn to 8J. We're deleting 8D. Everybody good? Can I get approval for the agenda now? We added addendum item.
Make a motion.
Got a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
Second the motion.
Second. Cast your vote. Hit your confirm button, Wallace, please. Hit it again. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Rick, yes. Dane, yes. Burge, yes. Crickmore, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Lester, yes. Motion passed.
Thank you. Next item, comments from the chair. The only thing I have is to welcome Ms. Fields and Mr. Lester to the board. Look forward to working with you. Is Jack back there?
Jack is in an attendance conference.
Has he assigned them their email accounts?
Yes.
He has. You got your email accounts. Go forward us an email. We'll all have that. And did we get them the contact information for everybody?
Mr. Lester is working on the organization chart.
With telephone numbers and all that stuff.
Oh, okay.
And remind everybody on the 26th, Lenore City, we've got our fall district meeting. And I think Larry was going to try to arrange transportation. Is that right or wrong? With a church bus?
We can, or I can, I've got a ride. I can haul about six.
Okay.
So
we'll work that out.
Two of us drive. We got it.
And, last thing is committee appointments. Next month, I'll have a committee appointment list. If anybody wants to serve in on any of them, I'll send you an email for those committees, the new ones, and the rest of us knows what they pretty much are. If you decide, have a desire to serve on them, just let me know. We'll put you on those committees. And that's all I have. Director's monthly report.
We have several items going on at this time. In your packet, you have a Elgin Children's Foundation, which is a dental program. Knox County and Anderson County. I guess you would say this program provides free and inexpensive dental work to families. They'll actually pick up students at the school and take them to a dentist. They do all the preparation for that. I would like for you to read through the packet, and then we can take this up at the next board meeting. In your packet also is a BLD Group Incorporated, which is our bus survey, and they have laid out a timeline for tasks. And Ms. Fay, Mr. Rutherford, and I met with them last Thursday night, so we've got that going. I've been the last 4 days, 3 days, I guess, tomorrow will make the fourth day, in Sevierville at the State Directors Conference. And the state has pretty much laid out a document for our school improvement plan. We did some work on that in the spring. So I'm going to place a timeline by fall break in October to pretty much have this wrapped up. So I may call on some of you board members to assist us with that. Also, the state is rolling out the next test by Questar. If you hear that word, or Nexus, I thought they were going to call it Next Test. We've had plenty of them lately. But that Quasar's the company. Nexus is the test that they'll roll out. And we'll scan the whole testing schedule and send that via email to you. Another big initiative that the state is rolling out is pre-K through 2, the Read to Be Ready initiative. And we already have a team of teachers that are getting that cranked up and going to that. Those are basically the comments I have to make, Mr. Lloyd.
Any questions for Mr. Nidecker about his report?
It's not a question, but I do want to say that I was real pleased with what I heard at that meeting on the bus evaluation, and I think the board and the community is going to be pleased with what they're going to do, and they are going to address the issues that we've all had for so long, like the overcrowding of some buses and some buses not full and some buses picking up children so early in the morning and the length of time that they're on the buses. So I really, really appreciate the board for voting to endeavor in this project.
Well, and if it works out the way we think it's going to work out, the efficiency is going to save us money.
Absolutely.
We may eliminate a route or two. Speaking of route, where'd Steve go? You moved back there. Let's talk about this Mr. Despain's bus. Tell us what the status on that bus is. We're getting a lot of calls. Yes.
It is back on the road. Part of the year, bus 44 was down inspection. And he went to get an inspection. The day he came back from inspection, he blew up the engine. He's now put an engine in and three transmissions in that bus. Got back on the road this morning in his bus. Bus to the holiday. He ran this afternoon. So we got it back on the road. But he did have to borrow bus from Campbell County High School Athletics for 12 days, and that's on the back of that place. So all together, he's missed 8.5 total days of driving the bus. But he's had other people buses and everything more than that. But he gives that to us. If aren't any bad luck, he should stay up.
Mr. Chairman, a question about that. Is there a process in place if a bus don't run, who do they call, and they have a time frame they have to call? Because I got a lot of calls that he in particular and some others were calling the school at 2 o'clock saying, I'm not going to run this afternoon. That's a nightmare for our principal. So I didn't know if there was any kind of procedure in place that requires them to call you or the principal or what.
They normally try to call us and the media athletes as quickly as possible. But a lot of times, they may let the girl back get up, and we're going right to move down there right now. And they are trying to get it back to us as quickly as possible. But they have failed to do that in some instances. We don't have any.
There's nothing we can do if they don't call. Is that what you're saying? I mean, is there anything we can?
I'm sure we can eventually, but it's got to take. Right now, we don't have anything in place to punish them if they don't call by a certain time.
Mr. Bain,
yeah.
I talked to Jack, our technology person. He thinks through Aspen, he can set up call lists for each bus,
mm-hmm.
and maybe even set up a text. So when he gets back, he's also working on our time clocks to get that all cleared up. But he's got two or three big projects going. And also, he said by November, the wireless should be up in all schools. So he's got about four big projects going on at the same time right
okay.
now. But that would be great.
Yeah, the quicker I know if a bus breaks down, but, you know, if they can call right then, it gives these schools and principals enough time to where they can call all these kids' parents to come get them.
I think one of the schools was there till 6 o'clock.
Yeah, that's ridiculous, in my opinion. They had to wait
Mr.
that
Chairman,
long.
I have a question for Mr. Rutherford. You've got here that we rented the sports bus. I'm assuming that's the activity bus at Campbell County High School.
That's right.
Okay. Do we have a policy in place what we're charging for that?
We, Mr. Thompson, I met, and we discussed this with Walter, here's what we determined we would charge that day. We had that the rental on a bus, if they would go local, it's about $50. We figured we would charge $100 a day. That goes back to the school and on that athletic bus, they have to pay for the oil, the tires, and all that.
Right.
It's at $100 a day. So right now, if we look at the old Kempcat High School, $90.
Okay.
Okay, looking. This year is totaled up to about 20 days. Is that all the buses? Is that all the buses in the county?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'd like to give Mr. Heatherly, Mr. Knight, for the authority to look into buying another backup bus. Because if we're missing, school's just been going on, what, How many days a month? 5 weeks? We've already missed 20 days, which I think $100 a day, I'd like to, if you'd get Mr. Marlowe and refigure that. But I'd like to give Mr. Headley, Mr. Knight for the authority to look into finding a bus that we can put on the route, because it's a problem every year, and we sit here and do nothing about it. And it's time we do something about that.
Yeah, we've got the bus on.
We checked with bus company here on 2008, with 35,000 miles, and we can get 27, do a little work on it, 29, about 25,000.
On $25,000, you can go to any bank and make a payment on it for 20 days a month missing, so we need to look into that and do ASAP. And I don't know if I need to put that in the form of a motion or...
We have to bid that bus?
Yeah, and you got a bus number in your package.
Yeah, that's right.
We did get for the cost of bid.
Last year, if you remember, regulations allow you to purchase a bus off of comparable pricing same year. And as long as you get same year three.
It has to be a national publication to validate the price within the national publication price on used bus.
Is that one of those? Is that one of those extra buses that Marty has, Mr. Jackson?
Yeah, he went. Thank you. Tell me they came out of New York, maybe, and they had it all behind.
Okay.
Yes.
We ran the numbers. Here's kind of how that breaks down. Walter's bus pays $218 a day. We basically, most of our drivers earn 65 to 70 a day. Take that off. 15 gallons of fuel, take that off. A little wear and tear. So we figured if they recouped us $100. Now, if we buy a bus, I'd want to get with Mr. Marlowe and provide us some sort of contract or lease sheet. We've already checked the insurance and all that out. That works.
They could use their drivers, same driver.
They'd use their driver, mm-hmm. And we would just, and we could use another bus.
I think we could use two more.
JMS and LMS has to take track and volleyball, and some even a lot of schools have to go on athletic trips. If that bus is sitting there, as long as they get a driver, well, we'd be good to go with that.
And, yes, sir.
My recommendation would be that you not leave the bus, that you would simply contract a driver or hire a driver that can't afford to do it, because any type of lease arrangement you've got to go through, you'd have to then be routed through the commission for approval, and it's just long drawn out.
You're saying we'd have to hire our own driver?
No, the contract with the driver.
Would have to be the same one because they'd know the route.
That's absolutely correct.
So Mr. Jackson already has buses available. So who is willing to sell us a bus?
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
Why can't he contract with us? Why can't he hire the driver and take that bus?
Well, you're talking, you got so many different routes. Me and you and him on the bus, you know what I'm saying? It'd just be, he couldn't be running all the routes himself. He could run his routes. But it'd be hard for him to run around down at Carrollville with one of his people that wouldn't know the routes, you know.
So all of his buses are contracted?
More or less, I think.
I'd say that's right.
I think that's right.
Your most seamless transaction contract with the driver that otherwise would perform the route whose bus is broke down. That's the seamless way.
But if we do that, we'd just be paying for a driver then, right?
You would be hiring a contract from your driver.
How does that come into the fee we were going to charge this person?
Based on some type of policy we'd have, based on what we would...
I just don't want to see where we're paying a contracted bus $200-something a day, and they only have to pay us back $100 to use our bus. That bus is going to stay broke down for a long time.
What I'm saying is that you would just simply contract for the driver that otherwise would drive the bus. You wouldn't have an exchange of them paying you money.
Yeah.
You simply pay them an amount of money to drive that bus route for you that year today using your bus, and you would pay them nothing for the fact that they didn't perform the route that they were supposed
to. Okay, that's where you make it up. You pay them nothing.
Contract.
three breakdown days per annum, I believe.
You pay them nothing, okay.
We start doing this, I guarantee they'll get the buses fixed, and for the new board members, for you all.
How many breakdowns have we had already?
We have 20 almost already, but it gets worse as the school year goes on.
And as we get the study in, it'll help us a lot, too.
Well, they're allowed, how many breakdown days is allowed?
Three.
They're allowed 3 days a year breakdown days, so Walter's used eight, so he's done used his three up, so we'll keep up this pace. I guarantee you'll keep up if history repeats itself.
Yeah, and this is really the first year we've been getting this stuff.
We have the bus ready. I mean, if the board, if that's your pleasure, we can purchase it rather quickly. And we already had it inspected by Jeff Harrell. He runs a diesel place up in Lafollette. Said all it needed, two front tires and maybe a muffler.
I would have one more question. Would it be worthwhile waiting until the bus survey comes in before we jump and make this decision? And that's just a comment. Do we need to see, would that have any impact on whether we needed to buy this bus or not?
According to this, their schedule, it's supposed to be completed in February, somewhere there about.
February next year. Mm-hmm. We got the one bus at the high school. Well, it's a budget amendment. Is that correct? We can deal with it when we get to the budget amendment?
Yes.
Okay. One, before I forget it too, in your packet that they handed out when we got here, there is a schedule that Steve has placed in here. Mr. Rutherford placed for Sarah and the proposed schedules for the nurses. So if y'all want to look at that, it's in there. Any other questions for Mr. Nidifer? Okay, we'll move on. All right, Jeff, you're up. Recognize Jeff Marlowe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The monthly financial reports, and for the first time in a long time, we have a budget in place from the month of July, and I have presented to you guys the financial reports for the year ending June 30, 2016, as well as the financial report for the month ending July 31st. And I get an opportunity to discuss something that generally is just theoretical. The school system receives money from the state of Tennessee in 10 allotments. And you don't receive any property taxes until the month of October and through the end of March. Well, that means in the months of July and most of the month of August, you have to operate with zero revenue going through the door. And we have this great running debate about how much is the minimum fund balance that you need in order to have cash flow. Well, on the very first page of both of these documents right here.
There you go.
Cash in the bank at June 30th, 2016, $4,553,000. Cash in the bank July 31st, $2,900,000. That's $1.5 million just like that. And that'll happen also in the month of August. So this notion that we can't go into our fund balance to where we have less than roughly $3.5 million, there's a reason for that, because you would not have the cash flow capability to run your school system.
Plus a requirement.
3% of your budget, which is 3% of 40 million, is 1.2. It's impossible. That's theoretically impossible. So just by half a chance, we have the ability to get the budget out on time this year. And you can see, without me trying to explain it to you, these numbers don't lie. 4.5, and 30 days later, 2.9. Big change. Big change.
It's all over state right there.
Now just dealing with the July reports themselves, the second page over shows you the revenue generated for the month of July. So our budget is $3,303,000. We generated a grand total of $423,000 in the month of July, 1.1%, as opposed to, in straight math, 8.3% would be 112.
That's right.
And so you can see that's 7 points off the pace. And then on the next page, your appropriations. Well, we used 4.6 for our budget, $1.9 million. Well, the difference between 1.9 and $400,000, $1.5 million came from cash. Real simple, easy to understand.
Dickie, do you owe us any money?
It won't last long, guys, the balance of the bill. But that's the point of the ongoing argument about what the minimum fund balance is. You've got to have enough cash flow yourself. The 142 Federal Project School Fund report next, July 31st, cash trustee, almost $400,000. We have $500,000 raw cash money there, so we're down $100,000 in receivables. That's almost common. The revenue is 3.3% realization, the appropriation is 3.3% realization. These funds stay in balance because of the matching concept. And then the last of our funds, cafeteria fund, we've got cash trustee, $732,000. Revenue 0.8%. You don't sell any lunches in the month of July, obviously, with some feeding throwing going on, and that's it. And then her appropriation realization, $5.6 million. Her other reason, she has to also have cash similarly because she's going to spend about $400,000 from July through the end of August, grand minimum, and that ramps up for the food kit to buy also in the month of August. That's the reason you got to have healthy fund balances just in order to sustain cash flow. That's the best example I could ever give you. I see it all the time. You guys rarely get to see the July and the June at the same time because the budget will out. Any questions you may have on those, I'm glad to answer those. If not, get a motion to approve.
Well, are you happy with where it is, Jeff?
It'll be fine. Okay. It's nothing unusual exactly. Like I said, I always get to see it. You guys rarely get to see it.
Can I get a motion to approve the financials, monthly financials? Got a motion. Do I have a second?
Second the motion.
Now, any questions for Mr. Marlowe? Cast your vote. Press yes and hit confirm. Anyone wish to change their vote? Show us the vote.
Yes. Fain. Yes. Hart. Yes. Crickmore. Yes. Hill. Yes. Owens. Yes. Fennelly. Yes. Wester. Yes. Motion passed.
Okay.
Next item, the budget amendments. We have seven budget amendments for your consideration. The first four of those are in the general purpose school fund. The next one is in the federal project school fund. And then number six is in the cafeteria fund. And then the last one is an add back to one more fund. That's split on the school resource officer. The reason it's out of rotation is because it butts up against 9 and 8 in the county.
That's right. Let's, since we got new members, let's take each one of them so they can get an education.
The way the budget amendments work is the first page is where you'll have a language to describe the amendment itself, and the second page is where the dollar will go. And you start off at the top, resolution 9-1. Whereas Campbell County Director of Schools has reviewed, this is a language that appears at the top of every one of your amendments, so tonight they have to recommend your amendments to you pursuant to state law. Whereas Campbell County Director of Schools has reviewed the amendments described herein and recommended the approval of same by Campbell County Board of Education. Well, you know that the Director of Schools has seen them, reviewed them, and given his thumbs up and see them. The next set of whereas is then describe the individual activity associated with them. In this case, whereas the state will pay for junior state the ACT test twice, these funds are being estimated and appropriated for juniors. And whereas student testing needs is greater than anticipated for the prior year and realignment are being made to meet the needs anticipated for 16-17. According to your exhibit page, exhibit A, the top section of the structure is for revenues. The middle section is for the appropriation expenditures. And then the bottom section is the equity balances where you're going to be funding something from a reserve or adding to a reserve or some balance as the case may be. In this case, on Exhibit A, see an increase in miscellaneous refunds from the state of $4,000. That's being appropriated into the evaluation testing line item here of $4,000. And then you see the realignment of $10,000 building confidence in here to pay for the additional theft exposure that we experienced last year, increasing that by $10,000 from $15,700 up to $25,700. Leave left tonight. Beginning budget is where you are here. Middle section, what you're making the change to, and then the ending section is the title of amended budget before it ends up in final budget. Pretty simple. That's the format on every one of the amendments. Resolution 2 deals with a change in the state schools grant being slightly less. Come over to Exhibit B, you'll see a decrease of $450 in revenue and a decrease of $460 in revenue. Resolution 3 is some realignments for capital outlay for CPE program, as well as the bus purchase that you guys were just discussing. So in this case, the amendment is being funded from capital outlay reserve that were not used in the prior year, down at the bottom. And you'll see an increase in transportation equipment of $25,000. The other capital outlay line, CC713, that would be for your CPE, $75,000, and then $27,837 for other transportation needs. 9-4 is in the general purpose school fund, and it deals with a change in the uniform part of the county. State of Tennessee and the Department of Education, your guys' case, establishes the account number sequences that are mandated to be used for any given undertaking. For years and years and years, transportation technology was not in its own quote unquote separate category. This year, the state changed the uniform part of the county and has created a category number specifically for technology. That account number on Exhibit Page D there is 72250. Let me explain how that works for you. The first number on the far left is the fund number. In our school system, we have three funds. 141 is the general purpose school fund, 142 is the federal public school fund, and the 143 fund is the school nutrition and cafeteria fund. The second set of numbers, the next five digits, is the category slash function. 72250 in this example. That is a new category number for technology, brand new account. The next set of numbers, the three digit numbers, to the right, is what is known as the line item. In this first row here, the supervisor directs that to Cannon. Wait. The next number, previous number, is a sub-fund number. We use four sub-funds besides the general purpose school fund. 991 deals with the instructional component of BEP. 992 deals with the classroom component of BEP. 993, so forth and so on, capital outlay. 994 is the non-BEP component. We have several items that you have to expend funds for that are not in your funding plan. So we account for those in 993. All of the transactions on Exhibit D are increasing all the line items in this new category, 72250, and removing them from the old catch-all category, 72210, at the bottom. You will notice that every one of these line items matches up with the line item down here that's being decreased. So it's just simply being moved from 72210 to 72250. That's a mandated step. The fifth amendment is in the federal private school fund, fund number 132, and deals with some additional special education IDEA discretionary supplemental funds to assist in purchase and training for the AMSWeb to honor progress of students. See an increase in special education grants to state, $10,003.82. And those are appropriated in two line items, other supplies and materials, $4,053.82, and in-service staff development, $6,000. Budget Amendment 9-6 deals with food service. We have a new requirement for food plans to report commodities within the E-Plan reporting module, although that is not a cash outlay for the school system. After reported revenue and reported expense, even though you never actually paid for it. In addition, the commodities to be recognized. For some school sites, blenders, small wire, steamer, microwave for water delivery, washer dryer combo for wind, etc. Combined with $1,000 for site for future equipment needs, and those funds are coming from her reserves. So you see an increase in commodities of $160,000, and that being appropriated at $160,000, which is just a accounting entry. And they're not going to ever buy $160,000, never going to spend $160,000, except to account for what they give. And then the rest of it is those equipment lines that make up the rest of that amendment, which is $35,640, and that's coming from her equity balance. The last amendment deals with the SRO fund. School system discussed last month splitting an additional SRO with the county commission at La Follette Elementary School. Presently, La Follette Elementary School SRO position is being split between La Follette Elementary and Valley. And what this would do would allow Valley to have a SRO full-time and La Follette Elementary to have an SRO full-time. The cost for the Board of Education is $33,899. See, that is an increase in contract services that the contractor with the sheriff's department, sheriff is the only person who can employ people who are post-certified carrying equipment. School system is precluded from hiring people who are carrying equipment. And a decrease in workers' compensation insurance, $33,899. As you, some of you remember, we got good news on June 30th. When our renewals for our standard insurance came in less than we were planning for, and that's the way the county commission is also funding their part, and you guys funded it. There's a $9,000 amount here that's for the car, and that's a one-time non-recurring outlay. So next year, your half will go down by $9,000. That's all seven.
Okay, let's take... Let's get a motion to approve and a second on 9-1 first, which is the action we're taking on the ACT test for the juniors. Can I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we accept that. And I would like to share that this is wonderful news because in the past, juniors were only able to take one ACT test that was paid for. And in the new law this year, they are paying for two. And therefore, that's going to help help improve our test scores because, you know, it's going to give them another chance at it because my understanding is maybe some people wouldn't take it the second time because their parents had to pay for that second testing. So I'm glad to make that motion.
I got a motion. I have a second.
Second.
Second. Any discussions? Cast your vote on 9-1, please. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Ward, yes. Payne, yes. Burge, yes. Creekmore, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Lester, yes. Motion passed.
Thank you. 9-2, state funding for safe schools grants. What's the pleasure?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Got a motion. Do I have a second? Any discussion? Cast your vote. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Ward, yes. Payne, yes. Burge, yes. Creekmore, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Lister, yes. Motion passed.
9-3 is the CTE vocational education equipment, which is well deserved. It's worn out. What's the pleasure?
Mr. Chair, I make a motion we accept this.
Got a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussions? Cast your vote.
Yep.
Hold up. Second. Yeah.
Is this the bus?
No. CTE.
Is it not
career technical?
Mr. Heatherly.
It is the bus too, isn't it?
It is the bus.
Yeah.
The $25,000 part.
Yeah.
And the other part is the equipment, is that not right?
CTE, the $75,000.
It's part of it. Do we want to take, can we split that budget amendment?
That's the question I was going to ask, if we could do that.
It's not that I don't want us to have another bus, because I'm off with children getting to school, because absolutely, some of these children do not have transportation, so if the buses don't run, they do not come to school.
That's right.
So I'm fully aware of that, I understand. My concern is that if we're paying for a survey to kind of maybe alleviate some routes and add more kids to a bus to where, you know, we have maybe 30 kids on a school bus and maybe 10 on another, then that may free up another bus to be able to pick up that route, we'll be able to pick up that route. I mean, that's just kind of what I'm saying. Is there any way we can just kind of wait until after the survey has been done, or?
The question is, can we split the budget amendment?
Well, yes is the answer, but not the way the motion is presented.
Okay.
You have a motion to approve 9-3.
Okay.
And you have to vote on that motion, and you can defeat that motion, and if in fact that motion is defeated, then you can come back and make a motion to approve excerpt.
Okay.
Could I withdraw that motion?
You certainly could.
Okay, the author of the motion is going to withdraw.
Okay, then I will withdraw my motion.
Okay. So we're going to split it. We're going to take the CTE equipment first, which is the high school equipment, which is $50,000 of that, Jeff?
No. Well,
what's that?
75, isn't it?
75,000 is the CTE equipment.
Okay. Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah.
What is the other capital outlay? What is that, the 27-8?
Acronyms used for, in that particular category, you have very few line items in state chart of account. Most of what you will spend will be in 799.
Okay.
But you're asking what it actually.
Understood.
Okay, so we're going to pull out the, do you just want to deal with the bus by itself? Okay, let's pull the bus.
What are we going to do between now and February?
Well, we've got one activity bus, is that right? and Jellico's got one, is that right? There's one on
Campbell
that side.
Campbell County High School has two, but nine times out of ten.
Fifth District has no bus problems, thank God.
But nine times out of ten, Mr. Ory, they're being used for athletic events.
Well, let's take the bus. Let's pull the bus out. Let's vote on the bus first, and then we'll vote on the rest of the amendment. Is that okay? We do that.
Well, I would make the recommendation, Mr. Chairman, is if you want to vote, why don't you vote on everything but the $25,000 and then take a vote on that second?
So vote on the 90 grand, the 100 grand?
Yeah, this 9-3 minus the 25,000, say it that way.
Okay. Is that more of a motion you want to put it in? So we're voting on everything but the bus first. Is that correct? You good with that? You want to make that motion? Okay. Do I have a second to that motion?
I'll second.
Have a second. Now, what we're voting for on everything except the $25,000. We're pulling the bus out. So if you would, cast your vote. Does everybody understand that? Cast your vote. Ms. Fay.
Oh, I did it, but it didn't take.
If you wish to change your vote, show us the vote.
Ford, yes. Fay, yes. Bird, yes. Creedmore, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Lester, yes. Motion passed.
Okay. Now I can ask for a motion to approve the $25,000 or not.
Mr. Chairman, no disrespect to Ms. Fields, but I've had a major problem in my district with recently and last year and the year before, as long as I've been on the board. So I want to make that motion that we go ahead and approve the $25,000 from the budget.
Okay, do I have a second to approval of the budget amendment, $25,000 for the bus?
I'm second.
Got a second. Any discussions? We're voting only on the bus. Discussion.
If we've had that many missed buses already, you attach a dollar amount,
that we said we did not pay out for that. What would be the payback in time on the bus?
Well, most of them are fitting that three-day window for the breakdown. The only one that I know that you passed the three-day number that Mr. Spain had talked about, I think they said the total number was
8.5.
So they got to use those up, though.
Yeah, that's right.
The same trend. We're already at 27 missed buses. Okay, they're allowed three, right?
Three per bus, per contract.
Right. Yes.
So if we keep the same trend, there has to be a dollar amount attached to that. They're not going to get, we're not running that route.
Yeah,
my question is, there's got to be a payback time approximately on that bus. And I don't mind doing it if there's a payback time on that bus that's...
Well, it don't stop there. When a kid misses school, that's how much. That's how much.
I don't know how to calculate or forecast whether the trend that you're seeing would continue and how long would it take. They're paying $225 a day roughly for a bus. So at $25,000, it's called $250. You have to have 100 days.
That's right. Mr. Marlowe, don't we, an approximate amount on a student attending is $7,000 a year. So if you take a bus, anytime a bus doesn't run, we probably have 10, 15 students that don't show up that day.
Grand's including our part, $49, $47, $4,800
a day,
somewhere around $5,000.
So it don't take many students missing to pilot.
Mr. Chairman, wanted to comment. It seems like we still don't have a set procedure of what we're going to charge them. We've talked two different things. I think that needs to be, however this vote goes, I think that needs to be put in place. What are we going to charge? We're just going to pay for a driver. What are we going to do? Because I don't think we have anything right now.
Well, that's something that Mr. Marlowe, Mr. Knife, and Mr. Headley work out.
Yeah, that wouldn't be for, I think they have, I would like to see that put in place.
We have to vote on it. I mean, we can do that.
I don't think that.
Robbie, you got any comments about this bus issue? I know it affects your schools.
You asked the wrong one. You probably asked Mr. Ruthers.
Well, I know, but it affects some of the schools. The middle school, has it been affected by the bus?
It always affects attendance, achievement. It all comes down to the cost analysis. Is it worth putting the money forward? The only thing in what's been proposed tonight for the bus that Mr. Knight and Mr. Root put forward, that's a 2008 bus. We have years of service on that bus, so you have to take your cost of that, factor in how, if it's going to be a better option than us getting a newer bus. There's a lot of things to factor in. Do we need more backup buses? Absolutely. I think what Mr. Marlowe proposed with a bus missing and us contracting with that driver on that particular day and the owner not receiving any funds for that day would be the way to go. We just have to decide when we invest in a bus or not, how long it will take to realize savings from our bus survey. Bus survey much needed. It'll shine some light, some truth on our bus system. It doesn't help us in the short term. So,
and it's got 12 years of service left on it.
The 2008 bus.
Yeah, they're 20 years, right?
Or so many 100,000 miles. Steve, can you answer that question?
I think they changed it to 20. Maybe that's right, Dale or not?
Dale.
How many years of service do you get on the bus? Is it 17 or 20?
I think they moved it down to actually 15. It went into effect for new buses, the old one for 17.
So the most we could use is an additional 7 years or something? It's 2008 model?
Depends on how it was 2008. Well, no, grandfathered in, this bus is in the system now.
It's not. It's not in the system now. They just bought it, right? How long is Marty on the bus? He just bought it at auction.
You can apply to get the 17, 15 or 7.
I kind of agree with Robbie. You know, you spend $25,000 for a used bus. Would it be better to? You don't want to start spending money on that bus. I mean, that's. Mm-hmm.
There's no easy answer. Again, we have
something that's going to help us as a management tool for long term, but we have several months before that comes to fruition. What are we going to do in that meantime? Are we going to complain every time bus doesn't run, or are we going to fix the problem now?
All right, any other comments? Okay, so we're voting only on the bus. A yes is to approve the budget amendment to allow Mr. Nidifer and Steve to proceed forward. So cast your vote. Lisa, hit your button again there. It's tricky. You'll get used to it. Anyone wish to change their vote? Show us the vote. And the reason I didn't, Johnny, is I think we should buy a better bus.
Well, that's fine.
I feel the same way.
I just want to have everybody call you.
I don't want to start spending money on the bus. Oh, they did,
right,
Mr.
That's just a lot of money. We've already spent $17,000. And then
you
pay $25,000. I mean, that was
my
concern.
Yeah.
But I want the kids to go to school.
That's
not.
There's a reason it only costs
$25,000.
All right, we'll move on.
You don't have to buy it. Look for another one.
Well, they will. They'll look. 9-4, State Uniform Code of Accounts. Jeff, explain that to us. The state just making this change. What's the pleasure? Got a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Second. Any discussion? Cast your vote. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Court, yes. Bain, yes. Burge, yes. Freeport, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Rustic, yes. Motion passed.
9-5, federal programs award additional special education IDE discretionary supplement funds to assess the to assist in purchase. What's the pleasure?
Mr. Chair, I make a motion to approve.
Got a motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? Cast your vote on 9-5. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Yes.
9-6, estimate commodities. I guess they're tracking that stuff now is what they're doing. What's the pleasure on that? 9-6.
I make a motion.
Have a motion to approve. I have a second. Second. Any discussion? Press yes and hit your confirm button, please. Anyone wish to change their vote? Show us the vote.
Orick, yes. Bain, yes. Burge, yes. Crickmore, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Lester, yes. Motion passed.
All right. 9-7, the SRO, 50-50 match with the county. What's the pleasure? A motion. Do I have a second? Did talk to Aaron before we came in here, the deputy sheriff, and he said that if we pass it tonight and the county commission approves the budget amendment Monday night, then expect the SRO sometime around late November, 1st of December. Got to go to training to the academy. Any discussion about the SRO?
I know I got an email from the county mayor that, if I read it right, he wasn't supporting it. Do you see any problem with it, Rusty, on county commission as far as getting it approved?
No.
Okay.
I'm not mistaken,
the diligence is there
also. We had denied members present last year, and the county commission was all
Yeah, I know. I got that email. So I didn't know.
Yeah, you're right. It did. If you would cast your vote.
Now, question,
hold on.
Is this going to be reoccurring? Is it going to be a permanent?
It is the 33 this year, and then next year it'll be the 33 less than
less
9.
Less than 9,000.
That's correct.
Whatever. Okay.
If you would cast your vote, please. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote. Thank you.
Okay, Chairman. Item C, we have one bid to review for a new maintenance truck. The bids were solicited for on August 18th. The season opened on September 7th. Received bids from three bidders. Olden Crampton Ford, $27,646.80. Short Redmond Ford, $25,390.28. And Ray Martin Ford, $23,634.44. Recommendation is to Ray Martin Ford, $23,634.44, the lowest and best bid to meet the specifications. And also the recommendation is Mr. Whitford, the maintenance coordinator, who's got a letter from the contractor.
All right. What's the pleasure?
I move to approve, Mr. Chairman.
Got a motion to approve the new maintenance truck. I have a second.
Second motion.
I have a second. 2 seconds.
To her Helen.
Huh?
Yeah. You got that, whoever did it. That's fine.
Any discussions about the truck? If you would, press your yes and hit confirm. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote. Thank you.
We have one of them added by the
agenda. Right.
Four items for consideration for commission advertising for bids. First item, camera systems for Jacksboro Elementary School. Item two, camera systems for Delco Elementary School. Item three, new roof for Delco Elementary School. And item four, school nutrition program surplus equipment.
What's the what's the pleasure on permission for advertising of bids?
I'll make a motion.
Got a motion?
I'll second.
Second.
Mr. Nidefer, how is that roof at Jellicoe Elementary?
I don't know. We had Michael Brady sent Dixie Roofing over to Elk Valley Elementary to evaluate their roof. And so you can go ahead and solicit bids, or we can get a group, get Dixie to go over there and look at it.
Do we have any leaks in it now?
Yes.
I mean, Dixie.
Actually, one's so bad that it's leaking on the floor and pouring the new treatment up. You're going to replace the floor if you don't.
The gym floor.
Can Dixie not repair it?
They could pull and see what. How long the roof's been on there, and also evaluate different. Generally, those roofs go on in sections. They could evaluate sections of it. So, but it does need to be looked at one way or the other.
Once we get the bed back. Is it a rubber roof, Chris? Do we know that?
I think so.
Yes, okay. It is.
Any other questions? Would cast your vote. Would you change your vote? Show us a vote.
Ford, yes. Bain, yes. Burge, yes. Creedmoor, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Lester, yes. Motion passed.
Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
I just had one question about the roof and the two cameras. This would be directed to Mr. Nidefer. Are these items on the principal's request from the principal's meeting on that work order?
Ms. Fay, I can check that for you.
Okay.
And I'll let you know, or I'll just send an email out to the whole board on that.
Okay. That's good.
I know that. I'll speak for Jacksboro. I think Chris will also. I think the cameras definitely were on the list. Is that correct?
I think so, but the roof is just
started leaking recently.
Okay. Yeah, well, that's good because we're just really excited about checking those things off that we get done as they get done. So I was just curious.
Do we have a camera system for the rest of the elementary school? I was surprised we didn't have one at Jacksboro Elementary. I know we have them at the high schools and middle schools, right?
Yes, and...
I didn't know that either, John.
I don't think we have many camera systems in the elementary schools, and some of the systems we do have, we've replaced the last two or three years because they were getting obsolete. Mr. Burge, I tell you what we can do. We can just do a quick evaluation and email that out, how many have camera systems.
They don't have them. Yeah, that should be the first place to get.
Okay.
We'll take care of that.
Ms. Faye, you're up. Assume the new board member knows Faye.
Are there any questions regarding the July TCA reports? I made a hard copy for the new board members because I didn't know the drop box was set up yet. And at any time you have any questions, come out of school, I'll go to the report.
You may want to give them a call at some point, tell them about those restricted accounts and the general accounts and how that works. Because you see a lot of money on this spreadsheet she gave us, but we can't use it for certain things.
It's not the one that the Marlowe spoke to. We'll have to take some of it. No questions.
No questions for Ms. Faye? Thank you. And I promise you, these meetings normally don't last this long. We just had a lot of stuff on the agenda. Items for action. Remember, we removed D and we added, as Jeff corrected me, J. So first item for action, consider approving board member Ms. Faye Headley to make application at TSBA for the office of the president-elect. I'd like to get a motion and a second, then we'll let Ms. Faye speak.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve Ms. Faye Headley to make application to TSBA as president-elect.
Got a motion. Do I have a second? Second. Now I'm going to let you say something.
Well, I just appreciate the opportunity to represent the state on this level. It's really, really good to represent Campbell County, and I take Campbell County's name with me wherever I go, to the Nashville meetings, to Washington, D.C., to all of the national convention meetings. They hear about Campbell County, and I appreciate the opportunity to serve in this capacity. It's an honor and a blessing, and I appreciate the support of the board, because without the support of the board, I wouldn't want to do it anyway.
She's president-elect this year, and next year she will be the president of our organization that we belong to, TSBA. All right, any other discussions, if you would, cast your vote. What did I do wrong? Okay, hit you. Anyone wish to change their vote? Show us the vote. What can I say? Okay, so we did move it to?
Yes, Faye, yes, Burge, yes,
Trigger,
yes. Yes,
Heatherly, abstain, yes. Thank you. Mr. Marlowe just pointed out to me, since we removed item D that dealt with the classified employees, we also need to remove item E.
Agreed.
Thank you, Jeff. B, consider approving Campbell County Board of Education's annual agenda. And Ms. Faye has been working on this with Sharon and Crystal. I believe that's correct. And if, let's get a motion to approve in a second, and then we'll discuss it.
I make a motion to approve.
Have a motion. Have a second.
I'll second it.
All right, now discussion. Ms. Faye,
Every year we are to have an annual agenda of items that we address each month in order to cover the needs of our system all through the years. So we had a retreat back in January, and these are the items that we felt like, according to Larry Nidefer and the other board members, that we needed to have address on a monthly basis. And I just am pleased with it. And if we do this, we're going to see some improvements.
Okay. Any questions about the annual agenda, which it is a requirement? If you would, cast your vote. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Court, yes. Bain, yes. Burge, yes. Crickmore, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Heatherly, yes. Lester, yes. Motion passed.
Thank you. C, consider amending the 16-17 school calendar to change spring break to March 27th, 17 to March 31st, and that's due to ACT testing.
Yes. The state sets the date, and we have to work around that.
I move to approve, Mr. Chairman.
I got a motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Yes.
What about families who have already made reservations?
Sorry. The state just gave it to us. Sorry about that.
Well, that's not... Don't have a lot of people
out
here.
We just got it. Larry just got it like a week ago. If you would cast your vote, it's a... Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Gordon, yes. Bain, yes. Burge, yes. Crickmore, yes. Field, yes. Goins, yes.
Heatherly,
yes.
Lester,
yes. Motion passed.
Thank you. We removed the next two items, so it gets us down to F, discuss and take any necessary action regarding the maintenance technology department scales. If the board members that was on here will remember back in July, and Ms. Gail handed us out a copy of the email that Jeff sent us, and for the new board members, we'll go over it really quickly. This is already in our budget, and it's already funded through our budget. And in addition to that, we've got a couple individuals that are retiring through our maintenance department. Larry's maintenance department and Steve's are down to how many employees because of sickness and workers' comp? And but how many's actually on the clock working?
Day six.
Day six. So you're down to six. That chokes somebody up. So the proposal is this. It's already in our budget to approve the $56,000. It's already funded. In addition to that, Larry has two individuals that are technicians. They're licensed. Is that correct? Certified?
Yes.
Heat and air people. And the reason this got presented back in July is we were trying to fix the inadequacies that we had in our pay scale. If you'll flip over to the last page, which I think it's this, and Jeff, when he went through our pay scales and our was dealing with all that back pay and all that stuff, we noticed that we've got some discrepancies in, and they do, there's two different job titles here. If I understand that, they do different duties. But we're paying secretaries, see there, if they've got 20 years. Ms. Faye, do you have that page?
No, I don't.
It's on that, sure that email there.
Okay.
About $17.21. And if you flip to the maintenance department, you can see what that range is currently. So we're proposing to change the pay scale to the third page there, see, the third page, which is $1.75 an hour for 0 years experience, first year. And then as they go up the ladder, the number of years, it tops out at 215. And he's done an analysis there on the second page to show how it would affect each one of the employees that we currently have. Now, there's two individuals that's currently retiring, and we're not going to replace those individuals. Is that correct? As far as we're going to cut the staff down from 11 to 9. Is that correct?
One employee has already retired, so therefore we will replace him. And with the savings we've gained from people being on workman's comp, see, we do not pay their salary. That gives us the funding. Mr. Marlowe can jump in on. That gives us the funding to fund two positions. If everyone come back, we would be at a full pool of maintenance personnel at that time.
Well, my question is, when you get done and all the dust settles, how many employees you're going to have? My understanding, you're going to cut the employee staff. Because like Steve said, you only have how many working? Seven? Six or seven?
we wouldn't be cutting the staff, we'd be back at the same point we were at.
All right, so we understand that we're still going to have 11. This is in our budget, and the individuals that he's talked to that are licensed, certified people will not come to work for us at the starting pay that is indicated on here. So we've got a decision to make whether or not we want to change the pay scale.
Mr. Chairman, do we have 11 or 12? It's shown here, do we have 12 maintenance employees, correct?
That includes...
According to this.
One.
On maintenance.
One, two, three, four, five.
And two technology.
Okay, maybe this
one.
One.
This is just minimal part-time.
Who is?
Dennis Brown.
He's not a full-time employee.
Okay. Okay.
So you got 11 and a half.
11 and a half, full-time, okay.
Yeah.
He's no longer working.
He's no longer working with Dennis Brown with the health issues.
And Mr. Thompson is retiring, is that correct? Thomas?
Ronnie Thomas has already retired, and David Russell has pretty much informed us that on January 1, he'll be retiring.
So the question is, do we increase the pay scale as indicated, as proposed, to try to get it more in line with where he can recruit people is the main thing. We had how many service calls on heat and air units over the last 30 days? And to bring them more in line with some of our other employees that's been working for us as long as they've been working.
Mr. Chairman, ask Ms. Knight over this. Is it possible to set a scale for certified HVAC people to where you pay them different than just based on years? If we're talking about getting certified people, would you not typically want to set a different, I don't know if it's doable, but would you typically would want to set a different scale if you're trying to recruit certified people?
I think that'd be a good question, Mr. Marlowe. Basically, we have scales for maintenance employees, secretaries, certified, classified. I don't know if that is doable or not.
Not within your current budget plan, but, I mean, if the board wants to establish any kind of pay scales that they want, as far as I'm concerned, you can pay them whatever. You know, did you tell me what you want it to be?
I didn't open that up.
What I'm making yeah. be.
And the whole purpose of the analysis is to bring them in line as to what.
Right. And that may be something to look at later. I just threw that out. If that's,
can you just do the two certified people and leave everybody else the same? Is that what you're
that's what I kind of what I'm saying. If you're hiring certified HVAC people, they typically make more out. I don't know.
But we've got certified people up right now, though.
I know.
You do. You have George. Is that right?
The proposition that I was challenged to do was to make up a new maintenance scale that would bring it more in line with the classified scales that you have elsewhere.
Yeah.
And that's what you have to claim.
And I'm not taking anything away from our secretaries. They do a good job, and they're very valuable what they do. We couldn't operate this Board of Education and the system without them. But if you look back on page 3, a person that's going to be working on our roofs and climbing ladders and everything else in the world starts out at $12.80, and a secretary starts out at $14.55. You know, that's just, in my opinion, I don't agree with that. So we're trying to make it more fair, and it's already in our budget. It's already been appropriated in our budget.
So these changes right here, Mike.
Matter of fact, I have no idea why we haven't already implemented it, because the Board of Education passed the budget with the knowledge that it's in the budget. I have no idea.
They wanted to discuss it, so
not the pay scale we did. Well, while we got it on the agenda.
No, we put the $56,000 in the budget. We've not voted on the approval of the pay scale.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we accept this pay scale as listed.
All right, I got a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I got a second. It's not new money. It's already there. Any discussion? If you would, cast your vote. Johnny B. Mm-hmm. Show us the vote.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. Next item is Johnny brought to my attention a week ago that the former Davis Chapel property is now going to be reverted back to the Board of Education. Gail handed out a copy of a deed. It's on an 8.5 by 11 page that Johnny prepared and gave to me. Dale, I'll get this to you. We need to, Johnny, you want to go over that?
Don't know a whole lot about it. Mr. Myers had dropped it off and requested that I put it on the agenda, and Ms. Nash is here too, as part of that board at Davis Chapel. And he could, if you want to recognize him, he could.
What's his last name?
Jerry Myers.
Mr. Myers? It's my understanding he's want to terminate the operations on this property?
Correct. The Davis Chapel Community Association recently referred the chapel back to the Board of Education. We approached the county commission and also a couple of other nonprofits. They all declined to assume responsibility for Davis Chapel.
Okay. Do we need to quiet the title?
What you know, what you'll need to do, they'll need to take a resolution. The entity that owns it, that they're going to divest themselves of it, and I'm assuming there's probably a reversion.
There is.
On that deed, and then if they'll do that, present it to you at the next meeting, you'll vote to accept it, and then we'll draw up a new deed where it comes back.
Can you help them with that resolution? Can you help them with that resolution?
I can. Okay.
You'll give him his contact information.
Yes.
And I'll give this to you before you leave.
Okay. And then if you just put it on your agenda for
we
next
will.
Month.
Yeah, help me remember that, Gail.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Meyer. Thanks, John. H, consider approving BOE policy 4.602, honor roll awards and class ranking. We'll get a motion approved, then we'll let the policy committee talk about it. Have a motion. Have a motion, have a second.
Second.
All right, now, discussion. One of you guys on the policy committee want to discuss this.
Mr. Larry and Crystal and Wallace and several of us, the Sharon, met to discuss the weighted part in class ranking. And when we got to Gatlinburg and we got the list of the new laws that had been passed at the General Assembly in January, it had already been done for us because it's state law that you have to weight, you know, the classes accordingly. There's a list there.
The state law is public chapter number 957. I think Gail may have scanned that and sent it out for you to look at. And the only thing I placed a middle college attachment to that at Kimball County High School, we have 10 or 12 students that are in a middle college program that are basically Roan State Community College students. And the honors for those 10 or 12 students will be presented by the Roan State Community College at graduation. They will receive an associate's degree at that time.
Okay. Any other questions? Cast your vote. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Yes.
Thank you. I consider amending board policy 4.605 graduation requirement on first reading. What's the pleasure?
I make a motion. We accept it as read.
Have a motion. First reading. Second.
I'll second.
Second. Now discussion. Pretty straightforward.
Gail has also attached Tennessee Board of Education School Policy 2.103, which we referenced that on the bottom of the recommended amendment. And one other aspect of this. All graduating seniors have to take the ACT or SAT to receive a diploma. That is a regular high school diploma.
Even the ones that don't want to?
Even if you don't want to, you have to take it.
It's the ones that just goes in and just marks a bunch of stuff and kills your scores. I'll agree with that. All right, any other discussions? If you would, cast your vote. Anyone wish to change your vote? Show us the vote.
Brooke, yes. Dane, yes. Church, yes. Cooper, yes. Fields, yes. Goins, yes. Everly, yes. Lester, yes. Motion passed.
Thank you. We have moved. We've got an item J now. Mr. Bain wanted to move Wynn Elementary Gymnasium floor. Is that correct?
Yes.
And this is, you're wanting to bid it?
Yes, to advertise for bids.
Okay, we want to advertise for bid for Wynn Elementary Gymnasium floor. What about specs?
Mr. Chairman, if you're not going to hire an architect, somebody will have to provide specifications. That's out of my realm.
How do you want to handle that?
Can we add
them for Elk Valley Motto?
I think we did. We have one already, Mr. Niner, for them, and some companies went and looked at it and provided what their opinion was, what needed to be done.
Different about that floor or something, wasn't there?
All they're talking about doing is pulling up the wood floor and putting down new wood planks. So can we not just
bid?
Yeah, whoever bids on it would just. I mean, we've got an example to go by. Well, can you make a spec, Mr. Niner?
I can if you guys will approve it after I make them.
We're just talking about taking that wood and putting it back.
Well, it'll be what kind of wood, the thickness, tongue and groove.
I'd be more than happy to get it'll with you if you want me to look at that.
It'll be all those type specs.
Okay. We can't bid it till we have it specced.
Why can't we bid it before we have it specced?
You have to have the specification as part of this list.
It is. How much is an architect for?
It's 8 to 12% of the project.
According to
the,
what do you have a bill on?
I have a quote here for $7,000
for the architect.
Yes.
When Johnny said a minute ago, I know that you guys we did Elk Valley not too long ago. Is there?
They paid for that floor.
Say again that?
That was part of that Nolan Baird money, right? It still went through the Board of Education.
Yeah, all I'm saying is, would that specification work for your...
I don't know.
Is that the same type floor he's getting?
No.
Because I think they're different up there. They didn't have an existing wood floor. Is that right, Mr. Niner? What did y'all do with the specs on that?
Elk Valley and Wynn, and we did the specs. It was rather on the simple side because it was a vinyl laminate and the floor was concrete floor was down. There wasn't any inspection to be done, so we.
I've been here for a long time now, and I don't recall the Board of Education undertaking a full replacement on the gym floor other than like from the vinyl situation there. They've done with craters a couple of different times that went in and shaved the floor down, or that's called, but I don't remember any
occasions
where they actually said the planks and all that kind of stuff. So
what did they do it?
I don't have any in mind.
Replace that?
Refinish.
What about Jellicoe or LaFalle Middle School?
Refinish.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, it's always been refinished.
We need a set of specs.
Do you want to change your motion or when you make a motion to include an architect?
No.
No? Okay.
I don't know what the cost was. It seemed like a lot of money to come up with a spec. I don't know why it would be that much money to come up with a spec.
Could you negotiate that price down, you think, with the architect?
I can try.
The benefits of that, Clint, is we do run into a problem. It falls back on somebody if we're out. Like he said, I mean, he's not in the bid spec and business.
Right.
And
And I know that's an issue. I know that's an issue.
I thought we did the floor like we did at Death Valley One of them.
No, it is different. I know that. It's different. I don't, like you said, I don't know the specs on it myself.
I agree with Mr. Marlowe, but he's probably.
One of the things that Dale said to you a minute ago, that every project they have in Anderson County, they run it through the architect, regardless of whether they have to or not. By state law.
These two architects love to hear that.
It's to protect the public's interest.
28,000 versus probably 70 for a wood floor. That's kind of getting up there.
And maybe they can give us an alternative. I don't know.
Yeah. What was the cost? Did they even give a cost to do the specs? Or
seven.
The whole turnkey.
To seven.
Construction documents, 3,000, bidding, 2,000, that's specs and so on, and then supervising construction, 2,000, total seven.
It's not really
so
that.
It's a turnkey job where they do the specs, they have to do the announcement of the bids, they then recommend that to the evaluation of the bids, and then they supervise the construction and sign off on the pay application to know what you're getting. It's a turnkey project. And that's my recommendation is what you do.
And they pay all the advertising too. Like the advertising. Is that right? I mean, they got to run it in the local paper.
We'll pay for the ad.
Okay.
We don't dodge, whatever you call that.
Deal. Okay, we're back to the question.
I don't know the answer. Well, that sounds like we may need to look at an architect to do the bid specs and all that, correct?
That's right.
So. What do we do? Well, how do we do that? I mean, how do we do that? Do I need to make a motion for that, or do we already have that?
You have a cost associated with them preparing that. Is that correct?
Yeah. Mr. Knight, all you do is sign the contract, and you're off to the races, guys.
Okay, so you just need a motion to approve this.
To approve that?
Yes.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we have. Was we going to talk before I do that? Mr. Burge talked about, do we need to look at renegotiating that, or is that...
I think that... When you look at these components, you want to do all three phases. You want to do the specifications, you want to wait through the bid documents, and you want to do your construction administration. That's my recommendation. I mean, if you want to try to negotiate that one price, that's fine. Just approve the architect, approve the specs for the building and proceed with bid. How's that?
Do we need to, after we approve this, do we make a motion to take bids for the floor, or when
Once
can we do that now? Once that's been approved?
Just go ahead and make your motion all inclusive then.
That's what I was wondering. Can we do it all at one time, or are we going to have to wait another month?
No, you can get it started by approving this thing.
Approve for bid specifications and solicit for bids.
I would like to make a motion. It would approve, before I forget that, approve bid specifications and to solicit bids for a new gym floor at Wynn School.
Gotcha. Yes. Now, what's the...
Second the motion.
Got a second. Now, any questions? You're voting on that? All right, if you will cast your vote. Anyone wish to change their vote? Show us the vote. Thank you.
Good job. Yes. Thank
you.
Yes.
Burns.
Yes.
Fields.
Yes.
Goins.
Yes.
Heberlin.
Yes.
Lester.
Yes.
Motion. Okay. We moved A up to J. So we're at B. Discuss proposed expansion renovation at Caravelle Elementary School. This meeting's lasted 2 hours. I'm going to have a workshop before the next school board meeting. We're going to ask the architect to come, and we're going to, the main purpose of this whole situation is they've outgrew the school, plain and simple. They're having classes in closets, and I don't even know if was there an occupancy limit on that building? I don't know the answer to that.
We've got two architects
here. Let me ask the architects in the crowd.
Mr. Knightford needs to start setting up.
I told you today about that, didn't I? What, is there occupancy limits on school buildings? You know, Dale?
Way back there used to be occupancy limits, and also occupancy suggestions from the state. They moved away from that to be so dogmatic about it because they reduced the class sizes and they changed
Okay. I was just concerned about it because they're truly having classes in closet. Clint's been down there. Faye, have you been down there?
No, but I'm going.
Okay.
Yes.
And maybe we can arrange some kind of, I'll get a hold of Lori Atkins and have her here at the workshop. And if you get a chance, go down. Lori will be happy to take you through the building. and show you the problem they've got down there. And it's one of our newer schools. It was built too small, and we have a plan to pay for it. And anyway, short of time, we'll bring that up before the next school board meeting.
Well, I remember, Mr. Chairman, when we built those schools, and our architects may remember too, that we had complaints that we were overbuilding those schools. You know, we had our little hard hats on, and we were working up, walking up and down the hallways, and we were told that we were just building those schools too big. But you've got to have a vision, and we had a vision.
And the biggest thing, they've added other programs. I mean, that's the problem. There's been other classes added. They've got speech therapy down there for these kids. I think Grace Rehab's tying up part of the building, which it needs to happen. You know, we've got nursing facilities now. But anyway, we'll discuss it at a workshop. We'll get it called. Legal matters.
Two informational items, Mr. Chair. First, we have the hearing scheduled for Mr. Turner later this month. You all are not allowed to attend, but there will be a transcript that will be prepared that I'll provide you. Mike Billingsley, who's been a hearing officer before, has been selected, and I'll be meeting with the staff next week to prep, but I don't anticipate any problems. And then the second, for our new board members, I'd like to do kind of a little workshop just with the two of you to bring up the speed on litigation we have and requirements that you may not be aware of that you have to meet with the state requirements. Disclosure requirements, things like that. It usually takes about 2 hours, and I do it over in central office. So if you don't mind, if you'll contact Gail and get together on a date. We usually do it in the evening, so we can do it after work, and I'll come up whenever's convenient for you. So if you just vote next week, just call her. She'll call me, and I'll make myself available around your schedule. Any questions? This is a great time to ask questions about how the whole process as a board member works, and we'll stay as long as you all want to stay to get you comfortable. That sound good?
And legally, we're in good shape.
Yeah, legally, we're strong. Okay.
Thank God. Okay. Is that it? That's all you got?
That's all I got.
School board members, and we'll recognize before I forget it. Ms. Faye corrected me on one thing. The meeting is September the 27th. Is that correct? So if you wrote it, is that
Fall
right?
Fall district.
Fall district's the 27th, not the 26th. That's why we got her around. She keeps me
straight. Workshop meeting.
I got to call it. I want to make sure that Sharon's available.
4:30, I think.
All right. Recognize school board members. Mr. Wallace, do you have anything? Ms. Fields, do you have anything? Again, we're glad you're here. Look forward to working with you. Brent? Mr. Burge?
The question Ms. Millsaps brought up, just had a question to Dale. We have volunteer coaches, volunteer this, volunteer that. Can we have volunteer nurses?
You can.
That's a good question. Good.
As long as you have an RN that is kind of overseeing everyone else, you can have LPNs volunteer their time just like anything else.
Because we have several, just thinking of, I know two or three people that's retired, that, because it's obvious we're not going to fund $1 million.
Johnny, that's a good idea.
But I would
that's
like
a really good idea.
I'd like to look into that and see if there's any interest in the community for that.
That's a great idea. Thank you so much. Ms. Faye?
Yes, a couple of things. Gail told me tonight that she's already made the reservations, excuse my hoarseness, for the state convention. So if you plan to go, your reservations have been made. But if you can't go, we have a cutoff date that we can cancel those reservations. The hotel, Opryland Hotel, I think is 72 hours prior to that. But mid-October, I think, is the registration. And if you know that you're not going to get to go, please let her know, because it's expensive. I think is it $400, Gail, to register each person? So just be sure and let her know if you can't go. And the other thing is, I would love so dearly to have 100% representation at Fall District meeting. And I understand we've got some good special speakers that are coming, and it's very informative.
Lenore City.
Yes, Lenore City.
Thank you. Thank you. Crystal.
I'd like to welcome the two board members for working with you. Mad that I didn't get two votes. I should get rid of the vote. So, other than that, that's...
Oh, that's a good point, too, isn't it? And we can't fix that, can we? I've been on school board 8 years. I think this is the longest meeting we've ever had. So I apologize for that. We'll try not to have that next month. We had a full agenda, and I'm sorry. Motion to adjourn.
Make motion to adjourn.
I'll get everybody an email about the workshop, okay?
I remember.
I didn't have. You tell Bob he needs to come.